Good morning and welcome to St Mary's. We're so glad that you've joined us for this service. And if this is your first time with us, an especially warm welcome. And if you're a regular, we're delighted that you're back with us again. This morning we're starting a new series, What on Earth Am I Here For?, in which we're going to be answering some of life's big questions, such as, why do I exist? Who am I? What happens when I die? And to do so, we're going to be looking at the wisdom in the Bible and how it helps us find purpose and meaning in life. Now, I trust these topics are going to hold interest for many people. Our time together will include some worship, some practical teaching from the Bible, and an opportunity for reflection. Now, our prayer is that you will discover more of who God really is, and that whatever situation that you find yourself in now, you're going to find encouragement and hope to face it. So shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have to gather now. Lord God, we simply pray that by your Spirit, that you will speak into our hearts, into our mind, into our soul. Father, reveal who you are. And our desire is that we are changed to become more like you. And so I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Perhaps you might think that this is an unusual place to begin a new series of talks entitled What on Earth Am I Here For? With a picture of NASA's Mars rover, Perseverance. It's just landed on Mars. Now it's taken 203 days, that's almost 7 months, to get to the red planet. And what's a little bizarre is there's a bit of a traffic jam up there. 9 days before, the United Arab Emirates had a spacecraft enter into the orbit of Mars, and China are aiming to land a craft on the planet in May. Why all the interest? Practically because Mars is currently closer to the Earth than it usually is. But more than that, because the planet's similarity to Earth means that scientists believe that there is a possibility of finding life on Mars, and then there's the hope that this in some way will shed a light on how any of us came into existence. It's a great question to ask, how did I get here? And perhaps even more importantly, is there a purpose for me being here? Hence the title of this new series, What on Earth Am I Here For? So welcome to this introductory talk in which we're going to begin answering this question by looking at God's purpose for our life and how in understanding that it allows us to make more sense of our world and will enable us to live a more significant, meaningful and satisfied life. The series draws its inspiration from the hugely influential book The Purpose-Driven Life, written by American pastor Rick Warren in 2002 and re-released in 2012. Now my prayer is that whether you're a person of faith or of no faith, you'll find this series informative and life-enhancing. In the coming weeks, we're going to see in the Bible foundational reasons, or purposes as Warren calls them, for what it means to be fully human, and in doing so, answer some of these big questions of life, such as why do I exist? Who am I? What happens when I die? Christians understand these purposes to have been ordained by God, based as they are on the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. And so this series provides an opportunity during Lent to go back to the basics of our faith and to be reminded of God's calling on us and the purpose of the church. So let's begin by reading from the opening chapter of the Bible, from the book of Genesis, which literally means beginnings. So Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and then verses 26 to 27. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and over all the wild animals and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. The Bible is breathtakingly straightforward. Everything begins with God. We have been made in the image of a creator God to be in relationship with him, and it is only through this connection that our human existence makes full sense. Now, this is further emphasized in the New Testament of the Bible, where we read of Jesus, the Son of God, who is the image of the invisible God. And so we read, "For everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him." That's Colossians 1, verse 16 from the Message translation. Throughout history, people have questioned the meaning of life and why we exist. It's a favourite topic of philosophers, and it led Bertrand Russell, an atheist, to declare, "Unless you assume a God, the question of life's purpose is meaningless." Russell was simply asserting what the Bible has taught and what Christians know to be true, that despite great human endeavour to discover the origins of human life, if you want to know why you've been placed on this planet, you must begin with God, because everything begins with God. Yet so many people start in the wrong place. They begin with themselves and they ask self-centred questions such as, "What do I want to be?" and "What should I do with my life?" This self-centered approach is found everywhere in today's society. The starting point, though, must be God, your creator. You were made by God and for God. Until you understand that, life's never going to make sense. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment, your peace of mind, your happiness, your family, your career. It's found only in God. Well, actually, in Christ, that's where you discover identity, meaning, and purpose. You can't find yourself by looking into yourself. You didn't create yourself. Now, eminent mathematician John Lennox gives a really helpful example in his book God's Undertaker. He says this: imagine that Aunt Matilda has baked a beautiful cake and we take it along to be analysed by a group of the world's leading scientists. They study it thoroughly and in time report back. They go into great detail about how the cake was made, what the various ingredients are, even how nutritional the cake may or may not be. But what they can't tell us, for all its beauty and all their skill, is why was it baked? The same could be said of trying to discover the meaning of your life by looking at yourself. Second, your life has infinite purpose and meaning. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, in his 1983 Templeton Prize address, wrote about how the horrors of Soviet communism had come to pass. He soberly concluded, "Men have forgotten God. That's why all this has happened." I would suggest such an explanation is also valid for many of the crises developing in the West today, the disintegration of the family, the loss of communal purpose. Of these, some of the more disturbing issues in the UK surely relate to the crisis in mental health and the increasing rates of suicide, especially in young men, and of self-harm in young women. Now, whatever the precise reasons for this, it's difficult not to conclude that they point to an inner crisis in many people as to their meaning and purpose in life. The Bible is abundantly clear about our purpose. As Warren puts it, your birth was not a mistake. Your life is no fluke of nature. And before you were physically conceived, you were conceived in the mind of Christ. God prescribed every detail of you. God knew you would be born and how long you would live. You're alive because God wanted to create you, and God has a glorious purpose for your life. Now let's read from Psalm 139. It says this, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me, for you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." God never does things accidentally. He never makes mistakes. He has a reason for everything he creates. God even made this world for us because he loves us so much. But despite all this, people have forgotten God and they try to live their life with purpose as they see it, yet without reference to God. It's a path that quickly leads to difficulty and ultimately to destruction. It's because of what the Bible calls sin, and it's clearly laid out in the book of Genesis, where we began today, and if you look in chapter 3. Humankind's disobedience of God has had a devastating effect on the world we live in. All of us are dealing with its consequences, a broken relationship with God, broken relationships with other people, broken relationship with creation itself. And as a result, every person ever born is left with destructive driving needs, trying to find significance and security and acceptance, but in all the wrong places. People go to great lengths to try and meet these needs, but without success, instead finding themselves being driven by guilt or by fear or needing the approval of others. Maybe it's through materialism or in seeking pleasure. It's so important then to know and understand the purpose for which you've been created by God, because it is only through this that you can truly have these needs met. And seeking God's purpose for your life will lead to many benefits. Amongst others, God's purpose will provide you meaning in life. It will be an unquenchable source of motivation. It will allow you to experience a deep-seated peace. It will prepare you for eternity. And it's to this latter point that I now want to turn. Thirdly, this life is not all there is. Everybody lives forever somewhere. In the book of Ecclesiastes, we learn that God has planted eternity in every human heart. That's why we have an inbuilt instinct that longs for immortality. And although we know that everyone eventually dies, death always seems to be unnatural and unfair. When we die, it marks the end of our physical body and our time on earth, but it will not be the end of us. The Bible employs helpful imagery to emphasize this. Our earthly bodies are described in terms of a temporary tent, while our future bodies as a permanent house. You can see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. So much of society today takes little notice of this reality. The West is increasingly hedonistic and pleasure-seeking, living just for the day. In fact, in recent years, even the funeral business has begun to reflect this, offering direct disposal as a quick and a simple way of disposing bodies. Life here on earth offers many choices, and yet the Bible teaches that eternity offers only two, heaven or hell. It's a stark reality. Heaven is described as being eternally in the presence of God, a place too wonderful to imagine. Some people think, well, eternal life, that sounds really boring. But the Apostle Paul wrote this, "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him." And C.S. Lewis, in his great analogy, says, "If you think of this life as being like the term time and heaven as being like the holidays," he says of those Christians who've died, "the term is over, the holidays have begun, the dream is ended, this is the morning. All their life in this world had only been the cover and the title page. Now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth has read, which goes on forever, in which every chapter is better than the one before." Hell, in comparison, is an eternity spent living with the absence of God. It's unimaginably bad, a place of darkness and separation from God. When you comprehend that there is more to life than just here and now, and that life here is a preparation for eternity, you'll begin to live differently and adopt different values, whether that's with regard to your money or in your relationships or in your character, because the way you see your life shapes your life. To fulfill God's purposes in your life, you will have to replace conventional wisdom with biblical wisdom. You need to live in the light of eternity and see life as a temporary assignment. The Bible often describes our time here on earth in terms of being an alien or a pilgrim, a foreigner, a stranger, a visitor. We need to be reminded again and again that our citizenship is in heaven, Philippians 3 verse 20. In fact, the Bible warns the Christian about the dangers of becoming cozy with our life here on earth. Rather, there should always be this sense of discontent with this life because it's not our home. In God's eyes, the greatest heroes of faith are not those who achieve prosperity and success and power in this life, but it's those who treat life as a temporary assignment and serve faithfully, expecting their reward in eternity. Hebrews chapter 11. But can we tie all that I've been saying together? Is there a reason for everything? Yes. According to the Bible, the reason for everything is to show or to reveal the glory of God. It's the reason everything exists, including you and me. God made the whole of creation for his glory. Now, the 17th century Westminster Shorter Catechism, written to instruct Christians in their faith, in answering the opening question, "What is the chief end of man?" leaves us in no confusion. Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. But what is the glory of God? It's not a term that we hear about much today. In essence, it means who God is. It's the essence of his nature. It's the kind of the weight, the heaviness of his importance. It's the radiance, it's the brightness of his splendor. Where is the glory of God? The psalmist says, "The heavens declare the glory of God." God's glory has been shown throughout history and seen most clearly in Jesus Christ. Bringing glory to God should be the supreme goal of our lives. Yet none of us have given God the full glory he deserves. Why? Because we sin, and at its root, sin is failing to give God glory. It's loving anything else more than God. We have all lived for our own glory, not God's. So what will help us bring more glory to God? To have this as our goal. Because as Irenaeus put it, the glory of God is a human being fully alive. In conclusion, Rick Warren offers five ways or purposes for your life, and they're seen clearly in the Bible, which enable you to bring glory to God and become fully alive as people. And it's these that we're going to explore in the coming weeks through Lent. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity we've just had to explore a little bit about why we're here on earth and what this purpose is that you've given us. Father, I simply pray that some of those things that have been kind of getting into our hearts and our minds, we will be able to meditate and reflect on. Lord God, we thank you that you love us, that you have called us into your purposes. And Father, you call us to respond to you. And so I pray, as we reflect on these, help us to bring glory to your name in all that we do. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your goodness is running after me. life laid down, surrender now. I give you everything. Your business is running after, it's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
We do hope you found your time with us this morning encouraging, and we look forward to being able to welcome you back again. Now, if you'd like to find out more about what happens at St Mary's, please join us again for other services, and details of these can be found on our website. If you haven't done so already, we'd love it if you'd subscribe to our YouTube channel, and if you'd like to stay in contact, do take a moment to fill out one of our Get Connected cards. Following on from this service, we're going to be gathering on Zoom to connect and to meet with others. And so once the service is finished, please make yourself a coffee and then join us online. And the connection details are going to be displayed at the end of the service. As we're travelling through Lent, we'd particularly encourage you to consider joining one of our Connect groups to help you grow in your faith and make friends with other Christians. If this is something that interests you, wherever you may be, please do get in contact with us and we'll get you connected up to a group. But now, I'd like to close with a blessing for Lent. Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.